Mr. Elliott's been praying for us.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us this day to come together. We pray that you'll guide us in our direction tonight that we should go as we take care of the business of this school board and this county. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we will do those things which are right, better need our kids, give them that they stand in need of. Lord, we ask you to remember this family, Lord, that's lost his loved ones, God. You know the need there. Pray that you touch lives and hearts there. And Lord, I pray that we'll continue, Lord, as a county, as all our schools, stand together and work and do the things, God, you have us to do, to reach our kids and teach them and not grow into good young men and women and be the leaders of our country in the future. Thank you for the blessings you're going to give us tonight. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Mr. Sharp, please.
Attention. Salute. Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Miss Barbara Neel and her husband Mike are with us, and we'd like y'all to come on up for just a moment. Miss Barbara Neel, in addition to being named our DeKalb County Teacher of the Year, recently this past, she also won the State Family and Consumer Science Teacher of the Year, State Teacher of the Year Award, and that's quite an accomplishment. I think from the gist of my conversation, I think that's not the biggest award she's received lately. She's going to be a grandmother soon as well, so I think she's very excited about that as well. But we wanted to recognize her, and I'll ask Mr. Monroe, of course, he's the principal of Valley Head. She teaches Valley Head, and I know in all of my conversations with Mr. Monroe, he has just speaks very, very lowly. I personally have been to her class, and I tell you, just from the little time I've been in there, she's very passionate about what she does. She's excited about it. She also taught at Ida for a while, and my wife taught at Ida for a short amount of time, and during that time, I've heard my wife speak very glowingly about her and her daughter, so I know she's a fantastic teacher. The students love her, the faculty speak so highly. Mr. Monroe, I want to let you say a few words about that. I want her to have opportunity to say things she has to say as well.
Well, I don't want to speak for her, but when you talk to her, she's probably going to say there are probably other teachers that are more deserving than she is, I can tell you there's not. She is a wonderful teacher. Should also say that her students are the reason she won this award, and that's probably true, but as educators, we know that our students are a reflection of us. So that she has wonderful students because she's a wonderful teacher. We're very fortunate to have her at Batty Head. I was just so tickled when she offered to come back several years ago. She had already been there one time and served a leave as a fourth grade teacher. But then the FCCLA job became available. She was in Birmingham, and we actually had to hire a sub until she was able to come back. And we were very fortunate to have her, and I hope she remains there for a long, long time.
Thank you.
Well, we want to thank you so very much for what you do for DeKalb County, for your students, and we appreciate everything you did for us. It means a lot. Now, I know the Times Journal did a great article on you, and I know these other media outlets are probably going to pick up that story, but it's just really quite an accomplishment. Thank you.
Can I get your picture up here? Yeah, come on up, please.
Get your picture back. Are we going around here?
Everybody gets your picture with the teacher of the year of the state.
Yes, come on. Sometimes as board members, we have to do things that are not much fun, but that kind of thing is some things that are fun, so we enjoy doing that. Thank you, Ms. Neel. Appreciate what you've done. Item number four, let's talk about bids.
Okay, we got several bids for you. Several here from the CMP. One is for a floor care bid, a carpet care restoration under there. It's an amount of $13,648.19. Recommend we approve that bid.
That's for the school year, by the upcoming school year, is that correct?
Right.
Correct. Okay.
Make a motion.
Okay. Motion is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? You can take Mr. Peppers or Mr. Richard, either one. That will second it at the same time. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Okay.
Item B is C&B equipment bid through your sliding glass door refrigerator. Can we put those together?
Yes.
Okay. A sliding glass door refrigerator from Resco for $2,960. AccuTemp steamer from DC Store Fixtures for $5,600. A pot and pan sink from Resco, $1,657. Cooler freezer addition from Dixie Store Fixtures, $80,900. Cooler freezer replacement Dixie Store Fixtures, $51,900. A floor machine from Mobile Fixtures, $4,520.93.
Okay. You've heard the recommendation. I have a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Here, second.
Thanks.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried.
Next is the bus bids. On the first one, item A, I want to make a quick change from 11 to 10 of the 72 passenger buses. The bid is a minimum of 10 plus. We got to talking a little bit, maybe the special needs bus instead of that 11th one. So in talking with Mr. Ashley and Mr. Cooper, we kind of decided that we need like a couple changes, or that simple change, we'll come back with a special needs bus. To present to you later. But anyway, make a presentation that we purchased 10 of those 72 passenger buses from Transportation South at $76,455 a piece, and that is a reduction of about $3,000 per unit from last year. So that's a pretty good price on those.
Okay. heard the recommendation, have a motion.
Make a motion.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
Second, any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay.
Next item is a Transportation South. It's a 54-passenger bus. We recommend we purchase one of those at $74,282. It's a Thomas bus. We had a little bit, when we took the bid, there was a couple bids that were very competitive. Bus Works had a Bluebird in Thomas here. We've had some significant issues with the Bus Works Bluebird. Of the 22 units we purchased a couple years ago, we've had 21 of those units and had 36 significant repair issues. So talking through our transportation directors at the state and stuff, they felt that was justification for us to go with this Thomas bus through Transportation South. So I recommend we make that purchase.
I'll make a motion.
Motion, is there a second?
I'll second.
Second, any discussion? That's actually on the out-and-out purchase, it's $84 higher, but on the five-year deal, it's actually a lower cost. Is that the way I read that?
It is, but we're not going to purchase the extended warranty. We're talking with Buck Ulaw, but apparently he's a fantastic guy, very well respected in transportation service. His suggestion is we did not need to go with that because these are very high quality machines, good Cummins engines, just a good equipment there, and that's really they got a lot of profit margin in that. So that from his own company, he's recommending that. So that tells you.
Yeah, what you need to know.
Okay.
You've had a motion, a second, any other discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carried.
Recommend we purchase virus protection from Sophos for a bid price of $39,639.
Okay, that's for system wide.
Correct.
Okay. Heard the recommendation, have a motion.
I make a motion.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
Second, any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? On-the-job injury.
We have one on-the-job injury from Ms. Devin Bolton, a science teacher at Collinsville High School, 0 days.
Okay. You have the recommendation, have a motion.
I make a motion.
And second. Second. Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I will say this on-the-job injury did not prohibit Ms. Bolton from doing a fantastic job with Collinsville High School prom. I was fortunate to be able to go visit that, and they did a great job. I commend Ms. Bolton for that. Really good.
Resignations or retirement. I got one resignation. Take that one separate and then do the four retirements together.
One resignation, Ms. Joni Mitchell, junior high girls basketball coaching duties only from drill ring.
Any further recommendation? I have a motion.
Make a motion.
Is there a second? Second. Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
All right, we got four retirements. I want to thank these ladies for their years of service to us. Madge Gower, itinerant speech language pathologist. I believe she's at Moonblade Valley Head, and she's retired effective 6/1/17. Miss Joanne LeGrand, elementary teacher at Plainview, retirement effective 6/1/17. Miss Denise Crow, CEP assistant manager at Hendren Junior High School, retirement effective 6/1/17. And Kay Young, CMP worker at Crossville Middle and High, retirement effective 4/1/17.
Okay. You've heard the recommendation. I have a motion.
Have a motion. Make a motion.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Leaves of absence. Guys, are there any of these that we need to pull out, or do you take them all through?
Okay. Miss Bridgett, we're basically amending hers at History Teacher at Crossville High School. She was going through the end of the year, but we want to amend that to allow her to return on April 17, 2017. Miss Sarah Goodwin, pre-K teacher at Plainview, maternity leave, beginning 5/1 through 5/25. orthopedic specialist at Valley Head, 313 through 525. Allie Jones, elementary teacher at Collinsville. That is an intermittent leave, 39 through 526. Ashley Crum, itinerant special ed teacher at Geraldine, 58 through 526. Mr. Ray Evans, maintenance worker at the facilities building, 31 through 614, that's intermittent leave as well. Ms. Misty McAllister, elementary teacher at Henninger, 320 through 421. Stacy Dobler, elementary secretary at Plainview, 1116 through 43. Ms. Alexa Williams, and this is a change to begin her today. It was originally approved for 4317, but we're going to begin today. Ms. Cindy Harrison, secondary English teacher at Valley Head. That's an extension through 4217. And Ms. Janet Duckett, elementary teacher at Sylvania, 43 through 526.
Okay, you've heard all these leaves of absence. I have a motion.
Make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Elliott or Mr. Schreiber, either one got that one. Any discussion? Do I understand intermittent means they may work some days, may be off some days?
Typically, there's circumstances where they may be able to work on some days, but some days they may not be prohibited for various reasons.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. All right. Placements.
Placements. Two certified placements for you, together or
separate?
Separate. Mr. Jacob Barkley, as I recommend, Mr. Jacob Barkley is band director at Crossville High School.
Any further recommendations? Have a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Motion is there. Second.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I recommend Ms. LaBranda George at Geraldine, as elementary teacher at Geraldine.
Okay. You heard the recommendation. Have a motion.
Make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Recommend Ms. Heather Vaughn for itinerant special education bus aid at 5 Special Service Center.
Okay. Superintendent's recommendation to have a motion.
Make a motion.
Motion to have a second.
I'll second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
If any of those individuals are here, we want to try to, if you want to get with Ms. Janet Williams back here, I know a lot of you, if you're here, she'd like to go ahead and maybe get you started in payroll because I know we got spring break. Maybe we can get some of those things going. But if you are here, if you want to see her at the end of the meeting, she can help get you squared away or set up the time to get squared away on that. Volunteer coaches and volunteers, Ms. J.D. Fava, softball at Plainview. Mr. Matt, separate.
I think it'll be together.
Yeah. Mr. Madison Bowling, baseball at Valley Head. Ms. Leslie Sisk, golf at Geraldine.
Okay, for the recommendation, have a motion.
Make a motion.
Motion is second.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Contracts. Any reason to take any of these separate? You know, we're good. Let's do all those ones.
Okay. Ms. Kendall Durham, that's a local contract homebound. Ms. Daphne Chandler, local contract for homebound services. Susan Cook, intelligence test for special ed, IDAB. Ms. Johnny Frost, that's a 21st century art teacher at Collinsville. Alicia Bryant, 21st century at Edmund Lake. Ms. Felicia Heathen, 21st century teacher at Valley Head. Ms. Lynn Wagner, 21st century teacher at Valley Head. And Mr. Travis Jordan, that's providing home transportation for homeless student out of Title 10.
Okay, heard recommendation on contracts. Do I have a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Motion second.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, principal contracts.
Okay, two principal contracts that are coming up. Item A is Mr. Donnie Jones at Collinsville. This will be from 7/1/17 through 6/30/20.
Okay. The reason we have to do these, we have to make that decision outside the 90-day window out front, so that's good. Okay, you've heard the recommendation. Do I have a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Mr. Peppers makes a motion. Do I have a second? Second, Mr. Richards. Any discussion?
Can you explain as far as the contracts, is there a new contract in here, or?
Yeah, there's a new contract in there, it's item.
Should be in the motion.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's eight, right after David L. You're getting close. Is there anything, there's nothing in this thing that's changed?
This is, I talked to Taylor Brooks, and this is just a standard contract we use. It's on the same salary matrix that Mr. Jones has been on. There's really nothing, you know, this is a pretty standard principal's contract there for everything.
Do I have any questions? Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay.
Item B, recommend a contract, 3-year period for Mr. Bill Monroe at Valley Head High School. This is basically, it's the same contract as Mr. Jones has. They're basically the same, of course, just as Mr. Monroe there on his salary matrix.
Okay, heard the recommendation, do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Motion, there, second?
Second.
Any discussion? I assume we don't need the same amount of time to look through this contract, because they're both essentially the same. Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Superintendent, you got the recommendation, we need to cover here.
Right. On the 2017-18 school calendar, as we put it out there, we said we'd entertain some suggestions, and there was a couple minor changes there. We are on November 10th, Veterans Day. I talked to Ms. Bliss, and we put that in there for November 10th. And then on March 8th, we wound up you to have to take off a day there, we modified that, and then on April 20th, instead of a weather day, we put that as a teacher work day. We kind of shuffle this around, but it really has much of the same features. It allows us to have 177 instructional days. It still provides for a week of Thanksgiving, 2 weeks of Christmas, a week of spring break, and for teachers who use a flex day, they'll still be completed by Memorial Day. So I think it's pretty close to what we had last year, just a couple minor changes.
You like it?
I had a lot of positive comments from a lot of folks.
Appreciate your work.
Well, I recommend we approve it and go back.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, there's a motion, do I have a second? Second, any discussion?
I'd like to echo what Mr. Richards said. I appreciate getting out earlier than has been in the past. And I like the flexibility that we've moved a few more days in that second semester, and I think that's better.
Well, that was a part of it. You know, we got on the instructional days, we definitely have more instructional days that second semester. But you also have your testing window for your Aspire, ACT, access, all those testing windows are in that second semester, so you lose instructional days. So really, when you have more instructional days in your second semester, really what you're doing is leveling it out a little bit, because the vast majority is in your second semester. So by putting, you know, 7 more days of instruction in the second semester, really what you're doing is just leveling it out.
Do you not have full-time schedule, or have you talked to them at all about when they're going to start?
Mr., when I spoke to Mr. Cunningham, or I spoke to him and his secretary, and they had not, at the time, they had not approved theirs. They asked that I submit them hours, and so I did that, and, you know, I haven't heard back if they approved it or what they've done, but I did submit it to them for their review.
I know Mr. Phillips would agree that it would be better for them to start at the same time when we did it because it takes good students.
Right.
Maybe they'll look at ours.
Well, that'd be good for everybody.
At least on a start date.
Sure. And I did personally speak to Mr. Cunningham, and I showed him what we did at the comp one day when we were at a meeting together, and then, like I said, I submitted to his secretary so he could, you know, kind of study over it a little bit, see what they changed.
I think one thing is, if they do start a little differently, it might be good if their some of their tech students actually start at the same time we did.
Yeah. We need to be as consistent there as we can for each of
Dr. Barnett, they have not approved theirs yet. They're meeting tonight.
Okay.
But their first day for the employees is the first, just like yours.
Okay. Good.
In the past, I've been a little, I don't like calendars. It doesn't have weather days built in.
Right.
This one has one, which obviously I'd like to have more, but the way I understand, we have our hour scheduled. We could actually miss another day or so and not have to make it up because of the number.
The state allows you to have 1,080 hours option, and we'll still be well over 1,080 hours. There are some districts, I can't remember the name of the district, but everyone like, it's like, they could have like 15 days. It's almost unreal to me how many days they're
Silicon
Valley. I think you're right. I think Silicon Valley. I mean, it's a lot.
Throw this one out. Bring on Silicon
Valley. I'm willing to wade into the water a little bit. we'll see how nice it is.
Okay. Any other discussion? Motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I will make a recommendation. We've had the human resource coordinator job sitting on the table for 30 days. I make a motion that we recommend that we approve that job description.
Okay, per recommendation, I have a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, item C.
I recommend that we approve the chief staff job description that's been set on table 30 days.
Okay, heard the recommendation. Have a motion.
Motion.
Second.
I'll say
second. Any discussion?
That's going to be basically the stuff on the grant.
Yes, sir.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Okay.
All right. Next item is advanced ed system accreditation. We've been working on that, as I've kind of kept you guys updated on that the last couple of meetings where we are. Mr. Mayfield and I, we traveled to Montgomery a couple weeks back, and Mr. Jill Wood and Andre Harrison, who's taking his spot, was kind of the state director there for advanced ed. They were there, and they kind of went through the process and talked a little bit about the new advanced ed programs. As I mentioned previously, every 5 years they update their standards So we're kind of coming in at a good time where this is the last year for the old standards, but they've already got the new standards built, so we're going to enter in at a time where we'll know the standards that we'll be evaluated by in a couple of years. I have submitted our application. They gave us a list of things that we had to gather information for. As I previously mentioned, we had 4 schools that weren't accredited in our district, so we're going to fold those over in our district accreditation, and completed the forms and application process. I've submitted that out with Mr. Cooper and Ms. Sherry, and they submitted work and submitted payment for the application process, and so we've got that kind of moving along. So we're moving in the right direction to get that. Spoke to a administrator from several districts, but specifically Dave from Decatur, and they quite frankly couldn't believe we were still on an individual school-based accreditation. So everybody I've talked to is just feels that's a really good thing. So I'm proud of the progress we're making there. I'm very proud of the progress we're making there. Item E is the policy report. As Mr. Thomas presented to you guys earlier, that report that we've got there is that large packet. Of course, that's got to sit on the table for 30 days, but I would recommend you guys look over that over the next 30 days. We'll entertain approving that policy changes the next meeting.
Okay. Any questions about that at this point? It's a good thing.
Item E, this is up to you guys ultimately, obviously, but as we mentioned previously, there was some uniform guidelines for federal programs that we got a memo a little bit late last year. We weren't able to get in our policy. However, it's something that the federal law kind of it requires us to do. This is something we're going to have to add. And the auditor is currently going through our books and working on that. So it's something we want to go ahead and get on there. And if you guys would be interested or willing to set aside the rules for 30 days and go ahead and approve that tonight, I think it would be wise and beneficial in terms of the auditor.
Okay. I'm not the motion. We set aside the rules.
Okay. Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed? Okay. All right. So the recommendation is for us to accept this guidance for the federal program. Okay.
Do we have to set aside the rules and then approve the guidelines?
Yeah, we just set aside the rules. So now we didn't approve the guidelines.
All right. Motion with the legal aid.
Good. I'll make a motion. I recommend that we approve the uniform guidance for federal programs policy.
Okay. Motion. Second. Okay. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Motion carries.
One item there that I want to add is item G. I've talked to you guys a little bit about the virtual school program. And it's growth. Mr. Bell, he was unable to be here today to talk with it. And I know we talked with Mr. Cooper a little bit. He's going to continue to kind of dig into the data and the numbers and stuff. But one area that Mr. Bell has recommended, and I've sent y'all that information, is possibly a specific location for the virtual program. That way he can kind of promote it a little bit more, advertise it. It's an actual building that the school, that those students can identify and maybe a better resource. One facility that we're looking at is out here on Highway 75, close to the Hilltop community. So that's kind of what we're considering at, where we're at. The rent for that building is approximately $1,100 per month. We of course take some utility costs as well. But that's something that I want us to entertain. I know Mr. Cooper's kind of looking at some numbers and everything, make sure that that's financially wise for us to do what we're able to do. Hopefully next month, I talked to you guys a little bit, or sent you some emails about it. Kind of consider that. Hopefully next meeting we can kind of make some decisions on that if we want to proceed or not.
Mr. Cook, can you give us some projections on that, put some numbers together about what our revenues, expenses associated with that would be?
In the next 4 weeks, I'd say about 3 or 4 weeks out.
Yeah. Yeah, but then as soon as you can send it to us so we can all take a look at it, that'd be great. Okay. Anybody have any other questions about that at this point? Do you have anything you're going to talk about this issue, or is that okay? Board members, we're down to our item on the agenda. Yes, sir. Since you waved your hand first, you go.
The last work session, we discussed putting air conditioning in Sylvania and drilling gyms, and Mr. Butts come up with a projected price around $15,000-something each to do. I would like for the superintendent, if he would, to recommend that Mr. Butts proceed on that project or those projects.
You're asking me to do tonight or ask
yes to
them? I'll give Mr. Butts.
I think that's a no for tonight. I'm gonna interpret that.
Well, let me ask another question.
You wanna try it a different way?
But how many of our gyms have air conditioning?
All the recent new ones, they seem like the building now, that's the.
Good news.
Five, Charlesville, Edger.
And eight.
So that's something you'll consider.
Absolutely.
There you go, how about that, is that a good comment?
Well, that's not really what I want to hear.
Anything else, Mr. Richards?
Nothing.
One and done, Mr. Elliott, do you have anything?
No, not at this time.
Mr. Sharp?
On the teacher units, we're gonna lose about 2.25 units, and we were doing, 6.8 units, level units this year?
Yes, yeah, this year, the FY 17, as a district, we're picking up 6.8 level units.
How much is a unit, do we know?
Well, roughly, I'd say with benefits and everything, you roughly talk about $60,000, because most of the time we try to keep them, the new hires is what we're paying for. So I'd say $60,000 per unit would be a good investment.
And I knew, I was looking at somebody and some of the other numbers, and somebody, I think, lost 12 students, but they're possibly would lose a unit this year.
Yeah, I think they're, foundation decreased 0.9.
I know some of the other schools have got several local units in it. As far as like the growth areas in the county, can you speak on that about areas growing and areas not growing?
Well, our south end of the county is really where most of our growth is at. Of course, your Collins and Lacrosse have been growing rapidly for many years, probably consistently over the last several years. Collins had as large a growth as any place, and percentage-wise. Of course, Crossville, if you go back numbers-wise, they've obviously grown the most. So both of those are big pockets. Five has grown through some states. It's pretty much the same this year. But really, south back up to Plainview has been where your growth has been. On the north end of the county is where we kind of had some decrease in enrollment. Valleyhead, fortunately, this year they went up. They earned almost right half a unit's increase, so that was positive. Ider, Moon Lake, as you mentioned, Sylvania has lost. Henniger has lost 2/10 of a unit. But really, Ider, Moon Lake, that's where kind of your largest decrease, that northern end, the northernmost end of.
Well, I know, like the Valleyhead, at least they are going in kind of the right direction.
Right.
Ider is already at 2.08, and they're losing 2.5, so that's going to be a pretty big.
You're right. Out of those 6.8 units that are local, 2.08, or a little over two of them, so almost a third of the local units are at Ider, and they did decrease 2.5, a little over 2.5 units.
What kind of numbers has Ider decreased over the last?
Over the last 7 years, maybe Mr. Cooper and Mr. Thompson from Bayville, just again, we were looking at some of that just the other day, just kind of meeting with principals about their upcoming units and stuff. And over the last, they're down below 700 this year. Over the last 7 years, they kind of continually had a decrease in enrollment. Spoken administration, I don't know exactly all the reasons. Obviously, some folks are going to, train their Chattanooga Lille, but where they've been working at for some time, some are going to different places. But over the last 7 years, I think it was about 20% of the enrollment. So that it's become kind of a trend there. Whereas, and I would say probably that over that time period is, as they've increased, the south end has been increasing probably like that. So it's just kind of it's been a trend, and we've helped out a good bit with local as I mentioned, you know, almost a third of all of our local units were there or are there currently. And just to be quite frank, when they lost 2.5 units this year, locally we can't pick that up. We're gonna have to have some tough conversation. We started that. We've already had some conversations this week. Yes.
And of course, the other one was Moonlight, and of course it's they're at 1.24 and they're losing another 0.4. And I was looking at their numbers, and the numbers have went way down over the last several years, and they're down to what are we down to now?
I believe they're around, the last time I looked was around 82.
What you know, in terms of how many
units do they have at that scale? This, for FY17, they earned 5.25 units, roughly 5.26. They're down for FY18, they'll be at 4.83, which is a decrease of 0.43 units. And we're picking up 1.24 local. So, they're a K-6 school, so they've got 7 grades. And of that 7 grades, that they earn 4.83.
So they get basically five teachers per seven.
That's state funding, right?
That's state funding. Now, you know, we picked up, like we mentioned, we picked up the local to fund those classrooms fully per grade level. There's also some federal dollars we're putting out there. We're picking up, probably 3.
There's a portion paid with Title II. There's a portion with Title I. I think there's possibly some IDEA as well. So there's 3 units. I don't have that with me. There's 3 units that's partially to fully funded with federal dollars.
So about 3 units together that were funded through that. So that varies.
Well, that's the numbers. I mean, as far as percentage wise, of the total faculty, you're looking at a large percentage that's not funded through the state foundation.
We're supplementing probably as a third. Well, when of course, that's not county administration and some of the CNP. We look at a lot of different things, but really, when we look at our teaching instructional staff, we're probably supporting as much from local and state, local and federal, as the state provides. Pretty close, wouldn't you say? And especially moving forward with the loss of nearly half a unit.
One reason, I'm not suggesting we make any decisions about that, but what was the number? Do we know what the number was? What's the last school that was actually closed after work?
I believe
it was around in that frame, I think.
Yeah, Adamsburg was the last school that closed in. I don't have those numbers in front of me, but I can find that information.
One thing, it's just to determine what the costs are. Is there a way that Mr. Cooper can come up with like a cost per pupil in all the schools and just see what it is actually, what it costs? Because I know Mr. Warren had it one time. And the number was a good bit higher. It was well over 100 at that time, and he made a recommendation.
So, you want the total number per student? I mean, like when I say total, I mean you want all the funds going to like each school, federal, state, and local.
Yeah,
right?
You think bring it down? Yeah. I mean, what do you know what the cost per student system wide would be? Have you answered that?
The average cost?
Yeah, that's the average cost.
Somewhere around 5,600, probably.
So it'd be interesting to see that and compare it to other schools, just to see what that kind of would be.
Well, and this is chasing rabbits, but Henniger, I know they've been very fortunate. We don't have any state foundation, any federal units either there. So they're basically operating at a foundation, as a foundation.
And I know Henniger has lost some students.
Right. So, Mr. Cooper, he'll be glad to get that information, maybe present that back to you at the work session next time, maybe, or I'm sure he'll email you that information in the meantime, but that way you'll have some.
Local units for the year we're in, now, 6.8. I mean, that translates into $400,000 of local funds they were spending. And one thing you learn very quickly when you get involved in board education, the only thing we have any control over is local funds. We don't have any control over state dollars and Fed and all that, any of that stuff. What we have to our discretion to spend is local funds, so we become a stickler for what those local funds get spent, what they get spent on, so we kind of try to watch that.
Across the district, it's my goal to decrease our local funds by, I'd really like to, I mean, out of that 6.8, I'd like to get it down, you know, at least as much as can. I don't know exactly how it all works out in reality, but sometimes you have ideas and goals, but through some retirement and some changes, I'd like to get that local down at least half a unit next year. We're not, you know, that'll save us, that'll be, you know, $30,000 right there, you know. And then maybe increase some federal units as well, because as a district across, we've increased our earned units as well, but we've got a decrease in population. We don't want to make dramatic cuts. That's not what we're trying to be able to look at, but maybe where we can, you know, shift some things around, do things.
It's hard to do things in the school if you don't have that local money.
It is. That's very important for us to have the flexibility to live, but of course, obviously, you know, fully staffed in the classroom as best we can, that's, yeah, you know, we want to put our dollars as well to do that, but we do have some flexibility that can help support the classroom that we have some flexibility with.
Okay. But all you had, Mr. Peppers, you have anything? Just a couple things to me very quickly. And while I'm doing that, be looking at April 27th to see if that day is good for you guys for the next board meeting. Dr. Barnett and I met with a couple of gentlemen from education planners a couple of weeks ago. They did send us a proposal, and quite honestly, I've not had time to look at that and digest what they sent. They're doing system-wide planning and a bunch of things. So, and they did often come to a work session to talk with us, so hopefully before next board meeting, I'll have a chance to spend some time going through that, because I had a couple questions just on the general stuff that I looked at. But we did meet with them, and we are working on something in that regard. We also met today with a gentleman, Dr. Barnett referred to a little bit earlier, but he's the safety coordinator specialist for Decatur, and he has quite a bit of experience, and we're working on our safety and security improvements, just say it like that. It was a great meeting. We started about 8 o'clock and quit about 2:30 or something like that. So we spent all day with but we've got some information on that that we'll be sharing with the board too as well, hopefully by next meeting. So I told you back in January we're gonna keep posted and updated on what we've got going on, and that's the things that we're working on at this particular point. So all those items, our action plan and Dr. Barnett's his goals and things, we've got a lot of things going at the same time, just nothing coming to fruition at this point. So just want to keep you updated on that. And that's all I had.
I do have one thing. If you don't care, just pass this down. Should have mentioned it a while ago when I got out of line. And I know Daniel Ledbetter, he's got a celebration at 6 o'clock for him to be named the board leader, so I know I would be brief because I'd like to go ahead and honor him for that great, great work. But the Crossville High School bleachers, the home bleachers, last time we talked about those at our last meeting and how the risk management had told us they, you know, weren't willing to insure. Well, we talked to Tucker Jones Engineers Associated, and had an engineer come in and look at them, because we thought, well, you know, we don't want to just take the insurance perspective on it, and had him come and look at it. And in the packet I just put in here on the second page is his recommendation, and basically he just says he recommends that, you know, we've got options as far as replacing or repairing, and he says basically as it goes down through there, he says in his opinion they exceed their life, and renovation is not the most prudent option. and makes a recommendation of tearing those down and rebuilding. That's his ultimate recommendation. And in conversations with Mr. Buss, they took some pictures which are provided there for you. I personally, based on what I saw and based on reading the report, I don't feel comfortable with repairs being an option. I think we need to look at that and kind of go ahead and start preparing to build that out. So that's kind of what I hope to be able to kind of bring forward to you guys at the next meeting, a little bit further action on that.
April 27th, how are we with that date? Is that good? Good with that? Okay. Anything else?